was amazing. Thank you, ladies. Man, that doesn't get you in the spirit. Excuse me. If you'll stand, please, now for the call to worship. We are called to be people of faith in the midst of the world. We gather here as people who live in the world, and yet
we gather as people who have been called to see the world from a different viewpoint.
God has called us together. God has called us to be part of a community.
God challenges us to consider questions of priority as we engage with the world.
In this time together,
may God open our hearts, minds, and eyes,
allowing us to see deeper, helping us to live in the world while still offering a challenge to the ways of the world. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. If the worship team will come on down, we will get started. Isn't it great to be here? I'm just so blessed, just so thankful that we have this opportunity to come and to be with other believers and to share and to just, you know, the Bible says to come together as believers, and it's just a blessing to be able to do that. From Zephaniah 3, verse 17, the Lord your God is with you. He is mighty to save. He will take great delight in you. He will quiet you with his love. He will rejoice over you with singing.
Needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations.
Thank you.
people said.
Amen.
From Psalm 16, verse 11. You have made known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand.
Wipe away. Here
Turn and greet your neighbor.
Thank you.
Heavenly Father, you are the King of Kings. You are worthy of all our praise. You are holy, Lord. Everything about you demands that we fall down before you and worship you. We pray that you would be with us throughout this service for what has already come, Lord, for what is to come, that you'd open our eyes and our ears to what is being said, to take it in, Lord, to drink it in, to let it indwell with us so that we can go out and share it with others. Or if we haven't, Lord, yet come to the conclusion that you are our Lord and Savior, that we need you, I pray, Lord, for those people, that they would make that decision to fall down before you, to worship you, and to accept you as their Lord and Savior. Be with Ryan as he brings the message. Speak through him, Lord, exactly what we need to hear. We just thank you, Lord, for who you are. In your son's name we pray. Amen. Kids, come on down.
It's green. Oh, there it goes.
There you are.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, so I week. So what if I'll pick on you Zerker boys this morning. You guys ever sit like in the car like next to each other and like go like this? Like this. Like you elbow each other. Hey. Kind of pester each other. And then if your brother did that to you, what would you do? Would you do it back to him?
No!
Wow, that's really good. I'm impressed. What about you, Ivan? Would you go like, if Wesley went like this to you, would you do it back to him? No. I picked on the wrong kids today. Well, you know what? Sometimes in our lifetime, when we're kids or even when we're adults, we can be mean to each other. We can pick on each other, say mean things. Like, you know, somebody might say to you, oh, your shirt's ugly. Well, then you might say back, oh, yeah, well, your face is ugly and I can change my shirt, right? Right? Yeah? Yeah? Yeah, we get a little rough, don't we? Well, I was reading a verse in the Bible this week, and I want to read it to you guys, and apparently you circle boys already know this, but I'm going to read it anyway. It's from 1 Thessalonians 5:15, and it says, make sure that nobody pays back wrong for wrong, but always strive to do what is good for each other and for everyone else. And so that's kind of what you boys were talking about, right? If somebody does something mean to you, do you get them back for it? No, we shouldn't. That's what the Bible is telling us today. That's what our lesson is about. And you know what? A good example of this in the Bible is Jesus. Because he died on the cross for us, right? He took our sins on himself and he died on the cross. But you know what? When he did that, the people there that he was trying to save were saying, crucify him. We don't believe in you. We don't want you with us. We want you to die on a cross. And he could have said, well, you know what? Then I'm not going to save you all. You don't deserve it. And you know what? We don't. But he did. He went to the cross, and you know what he said? He said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. So that's what he wants from the rest of us, too. He wants us to forgive and not to pay back wrong for wrong, but to forgive others and do what's best for them, right? Okay, let's have a short prayer here. Lord Jesus, we thank you so much for this lesson. Lord, I thank you for these children who have you in their hearts, and they want to live for you, and they follow these words of the Bible. Lord, I just thank you. I pray that you would give us the courage always to follow these words and to do what's best for each other in your name. So, Lord, we ask now that you go with us and you remind us of this. Anytime that we're tempted to get someone back, let's not pay back wrong for wrong, but let's do what's right. Lord, we thank you for being with us, for your spirit being with us, and for this morning worship service, Lord. And I pray that you will go with us from here and with the kids as they go down to their lessons, Lord. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. And Brogan has some treats for you back there, so you guys can grab those as you go back. Yeah, Brogan's having a busy morning.
He's done one.
Good job. There's some treats back over here.
At this time, we have our offering, and we do have plates at either door, and as always, you can give online.
All right, so I got a special announcement that is near and dear to my heart. I have to wait until the kids go downstairs. I've done this once before already. And we just got done with our first group and had amazing results and healing and recovery and was just awesome. But we are about to start another group, so I need to do this announcement so that men are aware and even women. The series that I hold is called the Conqueror Series. Becoming a conqueror, conquering porn addiction, is what we do. It's so prevalent it right now. Let's see if this works. Hey, there we go. Right now, polls actually show actively searching young adults, Christian young adults, 18 to 24. 76% of them admit to actively searching out porn. 60% to actively searching out porn. And over 50% of pastors nationwide actively search out porn. This is a huge issue in the church alone. In culture, it's even bigger. It's the numbers are ridiculous. The effects that porn have in the home, 47% of families say that they have a problem with porn in their home with children or parents. Like I said, these polls are a little old, so it's even worse now. It's continuously getting worse. 56% of divorces now are caused by porn in the home. Porn in the home increases the chances of infidelity by 300%. 1 Corinthians 6:18 says, "Flee sexual immorality. Every other sin a person commits is outside the body, but the person who is sexually immoral sins against his own body." I can tell you about all the sexually transmitted diseases and everything. You guys know that. But what you may not know is that porn has a effect on the brain. I don't know about you. When I was in high school, I did not want to touch drugs whatsoever because I didn't want them messing with my brain. Little did I know that porn actually can mess with your brain that much more than synthetic and regular drugs. On the left side is a normal brain. See how it is whole and fairly smooth? The middle brain is a cocaine addict with the bumps and the holes of connectivity. So these are neuron activity. So where there is holes, that means that part of your brain is no longer connected or actively working. The one on the right is a porn addict. Each drug affects different parts of the brain. Porn specifically affects the prefrontal cortex. And so you see a lot more holes towards the front or top of the brain on the picture. The effects of porn on the brain can actually cause more aggressive behaviors, more irritability. You're quicker to anger, you're more impulsive. Your reward valuation is not correct. So when you have any type of form of pleasure or discipline, you don't think about those. So if you have a discipline issue, there might be a problem there. Less empathetic to other people, you're more selfish. Short-term memory is affected. And then social interference, your relationships take a hit, moral decisions, and ED. Old self, which belongs to your former manner of life and is corrupt through deceitful desires, and to be renewed in the spirit of your minds. The Bible, before even science started discovering neuroplasticity, which is a new discovery within the past less than 100 years, knew that you can renew your mind, renew your thinking. We constantly talk about think, be, do. You're changing the way you think. So, that said, men, please, if you are suffering or having troubles with this, don't go, "Well, I can quit anytime." If you could quit anytime, you would have quit by now. If you think that you have it under control or you can do it on your own, you cannot. I am living proof to that. Many, many men that I've worked with are proof of that. So be brave, be courageous, and be free. These are several verses from the Bible that I love. "Out of my distress, I called on the Lord. The Lord answered me and set me free. For liberty, Christ has set us free, and stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to the yoke of slavery. Do not fall back into this. For you were called to freedom, brothers. So if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed. There's my contact information. We are going to be starting in 2 weeks. Please get a hold of me. I'll give you the information and everything. Men, if you haven't confessed this to your spouses or your significant other, I understand that. It is a very difficult step. And we go over and teach how the best way to do that is. But women, if this is something that your husband needs or whatnot, please, please be understanding and forgiving and wait upon the Lord for healing in him. There's a course that it will be coming out this year through the same people that put on the Conquer series through Soul Refiner. It is specifically geared towards women that have had a spouse that the wife has gone through betrayal or infidelity for healing on that part. This affects the relationship, affects both sides. 80% of women that have had a spouse actively searching out porn results in depression in that woman. 80%. Men, we might be just affecting our bodies, but we're not only affecting ourselves. We're affecting everyone around us. So women, I ask for grace and forgiveness and understanding if your husband comes out and wants restoration. That's what we need. A messed up man contributes to a family. That family becomes messed up. Messed up man contributes to a messed up family. A messed up family contributes to a church. That church becomes messed up. Messed up man contributes to a messed up family. A messed up family contributes to a messed up church. And that messed up church contributes to the community. Okay? It starts with ourselves. I fully believe that sexual immorality within the world has become so rampant because we don't take care of ourselves. It's called plank eye. We don't take care of the plank in our own eye first. And then we can't stand up against the stuff that comes out culturally. Because if we stand up and all of a sudden we're scrutinized and they discover what we're doing, then we have no leg to stand on. So this starts with us, guys. Women, I am trying to, because sexual immorality is becoming so more rampant in culture, women are experiencing this addiction more and more as well. The numbers are skyrocketing. I believe it's 30%. It's between 30 and 40% right now. And so it's going up. So I am trying to put together a course specifically for women. This course is geared towards porn, but the process helps with addiction, period, from a Christian standpoint. So if you are having troubles with alcoholism or any of that fact, this course will help you as well. If you know of anyone that is suffering outside of this church, this is not just for this church, okay? I'm actively searching for men outside of this church to go through this as well to help this community. So I will put this information out on the website as well. That way we can get as many men going as possible. So that's all I have. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Lucas. And now we'll move into a time of sharing joys and concerns and a time of prayer. I just ask you guys to keep my family in your prayers. We're sick again. Not me. I'm fine, but the rest of the family is home today, sick again. And so just keep us in your prayers. And also, there was a request sent in for Jonna and Matthew, and they're feeling sick and fever and achy and all that. So please keep them in your prayers as well. And we also just pray for Clint today as he's speaking at DeGraff. And so just as today, we're going to lift him up and just ask that the Lord would speak through him today as he shares with that community, that part of the body of Christ in DeGraff. So, if you would, please go ahead and pray with me. Oh, Heavenly Father, we thank you, we praise you, we worship you, we lift you high. Thank you that you are Emmanuel, God with us. You are high and lifted up, seated on the throne, separate, above, but you are also Emmanuel, God with us. And you care. So, Lord, we just lift up these requests today from this church family. First, I just pray for anyone here who's sick, who's feeling under the weather, who's maybe watching from home because they can't get out right now. Lord, I pray that you would just be with them, that your presence would be felt by them. They'd be able to experience your comfort and your joy and your peace and your love and your healing touch. And I pray specifically for Jonah and Matthew. Pray that you just come and touch their bodies, heal them, bring healing and wholeness to them right now, Lord. Pray that you just touch them. Lord, we also just lift up Clint today. Thank you for his faithfulness to follow where you've called him and to preach your good news wherever you've called him. And so, Lord, we just pray that you would just be with him, anoint him today, that he would speak your truth boldly. As he is one of our community, one of our family, and we are sending him out to preach your good news. He is he's a sent one from here, from Aulne, to go. And so, Lord, we just pray that you would just touch his lips, anoint him, that he would speak your truth, your love boldly. The others would come to know you in a more significant, more real way. They'd be transformed through your truth. Again, we just come before you today thankful and grateful for all that you've done. Lord, we said it at the beginning, but Lord, you are so good all the time. Even in the midst of trials and tribulations, you are good. You hold us up. You keep us going. You give us strength to endure. And so, Lord, we just thank you. Thank you for your love. Thank you for the love that you've given us, you've lavished on us, that you've made us children of God. Thank you, you've even given us a way to commune with you. You've made us right in your sight, but you've also taught us how to pray, as you taught the disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
If you'll stand, please, now, if you're able, and we'll, in recognition of God's word. We are reading from Philippians 3, 7 through 14. But whatever were gains to me, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them garbage that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God on the basis of faith. I want to arrive at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. And all God's people said, Amen. Amen.
Good morning. It's good to be back again. Hope you all are doing well. Today, I wanted to just, as I was trying to discern what the Lord wanted to speak today, I was just reading through some scriptures, and this one just kind of jumped off the page at me. And actually, the whole first part of the third chapter here was really, the Lord was speaking to me through it. And so I just thought I'd share some of my thoughts and some of what the Lord was speaking to me through this time. The church, this is a letter, is written to the church in Philippi from Paul the Apostle. And from the time that this church was established, it was a healthy church, a strong church, a generous church. It wasn't a problem church. It wasn't a church that needed a lot of rebuke, a lot of correcting. And from the letter that we see, there's a lot of encouragement. This is if you read the letter to the Philippians, it's joy, joy, joy. There's lots of joy in this book, just reminding people and encouraging people. And in the fourth chapter, it talks, you know, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I'll say rejoice. And so there's just a lot of that in this book. And so I say that because I think that it's good for us to be reminded that, you know, just because, you know, we're a church who doesn't, and we don't have all the problems that we see maybe in 1 Corinthians and a lot of disunity and different things. No, this is a church that is healthy and strong. And here, this is a message that Paul is giving to a church that's healthy and strong and generous. And I think that that's important. I think that that's good to remember. And so I just want to walk through some of these verses. I'm just going to kind of walk through verse by verse today and just go through verses 7 through 14. And so he starts off with this in verse 7. He says, whatever things were gained to me, I count as loss because of Christ. And he had just gotten through, if I could have, and I maybe should have, there's 1 through 14 was really powerful, and I like it. But in verses 4 through 6, right before this, he talks about all the ways that he has confidence in the flesh, confidence in himself. He says that he was circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews. He's talking about his heritage. His nationality, he's proud of this, right? He's proud of where he came from and the background that he was raised in, okay? So he's proud of that. And he says, in regard to the law, he was a Pharisee. He had status. He was, maybe we consider a religious leader of the time, right? And so he had power and insight, and he was, a person of influence. As for zeal, he says, I was persecuting the church. He wanted to protect the integrity of the religion, the Judaism, right? He wanted to protect it. And he was so zealous for the Lord that he was going out to persecute. Before he came to know the Lord, he was out to persecute and to just zealous for keeping it pure and keeping it right. And then he says, as for righteousness based on the law, faultless. There's this. He did all the right things. He followed the law as well as he could, right? He did these things. And all of these things are something to be proud of. But he says, now, whatever was gained to me, whatever I was proud of, whatever I did hold high in esteem for myself, because of Christ, I count them all loss because of Christ. And so as I was thinking, I was trying to think of my own version of this that Paul just goes through, right? And so for me, it could be I was born into a Christian family. My father and my mother raised me in the faith. Their fathers and mothers were Christians when I was born. And so I have this heritage that I was grown up in, that I was born into, that I learned from the time I was born, right, of the faith. And I grew up and I was proud of that. I was the son of a pastor, right? The son of a pastor. And I went to church every Sunday and Wednesday. And sometimes other days that it was open as well. Like I was always in church. most of the time of my own free will, sometimes dragged by my ear, but nonetheless, I was there. I studied ministry in my undergrad and graduate school. I learned the right things. I learned how to read and study the Bible. I learned what the Bible is trying to tell us and the story of the whole scripture. I learned these things. I spent time and money, lots of money, studying and being taught by professors who've dedicated their lives to studying this thing. I spent 2 years overseas in China serving in missions for the gospel of Christ. And as for righteousness, as Paul says here as he ended, yeah, I did the right things. I did my best. My sisters didn't like it because they always called me the golden child. But I didn't drink, I didn't smoke, I didn't hang out with those that did. I was a good kid, right? And so all of these things that I was proud of, they were good. There's nothing bad about them. But what Paul's saying is all of that is counted loss compared to knowing Christ. Knowing Christ surpasses all of this. Yet I count them all loss. Matthew Henry says, he's a Bible scholar and he wrote some commentaries, and he says, he counted them loss not only as insufficient to enrich him. Enrich is to improve or to enhance him. Like are they insufficient to enrich him, but would certainly impoverish and ruin him if he trusted them in opposition to Christ. So if we place our trust in these things in opposition to Christ, they will actually not just not enhance us or enrich us, but they would actually impoverish us and ruin us, is what Matthew Henry would say. Now, he doesn't stop there. Paul continues on in verse 8, and he says, what is more? What is more? I don't just count them as loss. He says, let me find my place here. What is more? I consider everything a loss. Everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them garbage. Some translations, the King James, it says dung. I consider them dung that I may gain Christ, or that I might win Christ. Here, Paul speaks of all things, all worldly enjoyments, all mere outward privileges, things of the like and kind which could stand in competition with Christ for the throne in his heart. And he says, again, these aren't bad things, but they're worthless compared to knowing him. And possibly a hindrance of us knowing him. Enjoyment. Thinking about that. I really like good food. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Music. Friendship. Wealth is a privilege that we have here in the United States, right? Education is a privilege that we enjoy, that when we look around to other countries around the world, they don't get to enjoy the same things as us. And he says all of these are garbage. These are all dung compared to this surpassing greatness of knowing Christ. I throw them all out. See, he had this. I consider this this thought of I consider everything garbage that I might gain Christ is this single-mindedness, this focus, this dedication. Like if I could only have one thing, I would throw out everything else and only have Christ. If I could throw out everything, if I had to get rid of relationships, worldly pleasures, all of it, if I had to get rid of all of it, so I could get one thing, the one thing that I would want, he says, is Christ. The knowing, to be able to know Christ, far surpasses anything that this world has to offer. That's what Paul is saying. John Wesley says here, in comparing verses 7 and 8, he says, the discourse rises. It goes up in intensity. Loss is sustained with patience, but dung is cast away with abhorrence. This Greek word signifies the vilest refuse of things, the dross of metals, the dregs of liquors, the excrements of animals, the most worthless scraps of meat fit only for dogs. He throws them away with abhorrence that I might gain Christ. He that loses all things gains Christ and is gained by Christ. So I have a question. Is my view of Christ and my knowledge of Christ so important to me that I would throw everything else away with abhorrence? Or am I content to keep these things that might hinder my relationship of knowing Christ? Let me see if I can say that a little differently. Am I content to keep the things of the world that might hinder my knowing Christ more fully, or will I cast them all away as Christ, or as Paul said he would do, he does, that I might know Christ more? Is he that important in our life? Paul goes on to say in verse 9, he says, and to be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ. The righteousness that comes from God on the basis of faith. See, when we're found in him, when we know him, we're transformed. This righteousness isn't the righteousness of outward actions like the law dictates, right? We do the right things so that we can become righteous. No, this is an inward righteousness that comes through Christ transforming our lives. This is an inward righteousness. This isn't just talking about justification where Jesus died on the cross so that we could be made right before God. This is an inward work that is continuing to do called sanctification, where he continues to make us holy and pleasing in the sight of God. And when we know Christ, this sanctification, this work is done within us. Matthew Henry says, This idea of gaining, to throw everything away, to gain Christ, he likens it to a runner who has his eyes set on the prize. As a sailor who makes the port, he's going for this port that he's bound for. This expression intimates that we have to strive for him and after him, and that all is little enough to win him. James 4, 7 and 8 says, submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Come near to God and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. This double-mindedness, this is what Paul is speaking of. See, Paul was, well, even before he knew the Lord, he seemed to have this single-mindedness. Right? He was so zealous for the Lord that he was out persecuting because he had this single-mindedness, this I need to achieve, I need to do, I need to protect all of this because of this, I have this fervor for the Lord. And then when he was saved, when the Lord met him on the road to Damascus, all of that zeal, all of that fervor went into his faith, into proclaiming Jesus. And then he was just on a terror, and he was just going throughout Asia Minor and Europe, spreading the word, preaching the good news, planting churches. Why? Because he was single-minded. He said, I want to know Christ and make him known. That's it. All of these things of the world, they don't mean anything to me. I want to know Christ. And then in verse 10, it says this. I want to know Christ. In my Bible, I put an exclamation point after that, right? I want to know him. Yes, to know the power of his resurrection and the participation in his sufferings and to become like him in his death. So in a few brief words, Paul outlines the four most important things in his life, I think, right? I want to know Christ, the first one. This idea of know, to know Christ. This isn't like, me sitting in a seminary class, learning all the information about Christ, learning about his life, what he did here on earth. This isn't secondhand knowledge. That's not what he's talking about. See, the Hebrew, in the Hebrew mindset, this word to know was a lot more intimate than that. And even though this letter was written in Greek, Paul himself, he says, was a Hebrew of Hebrews. He thought in Hebrew thinking. And so as you look through in the Hebrew scriptures, in the Old Testament, as we call it, you'll see this word, it's often translated as other things, but this word to know is often translated between husband and wife. Adam knew his wife, and she bore a son. Elkanah, in 1 Samuel, in the first chapter, I believe, knew his wife, and Samuel was born. It's this intimate knowing, this personal connection, this experiential relationship. It's more than just knowing things from reading and knowing things and having this intellectual knowledge. It's this experiential relational piece to knowing Christ. I don't think Paul is saying that he wants to give up everything just to be able to know all the things that Jesus did and to learn about all the miracles that he accomplished. Right? No. He's saying, I will give up everything so that I might know him, that I might have an experiential relationship with him, that I might hear his voice and experience him. The second thing he says, so the first one is to he might know Christ. The second one that he says is that he might know the power of Christ's resurrection. The death and resurrection of Jesus was more than just something that happened once upon a time, right? It was a historic demonstration of God's attitude and his power. When we come to a place where our own dreams and preferences and possessions and agendas die and we let them fall to the ground, that very same power that raised Jesus from the dead then can have work and comes alive in our own story. The resurrection power is what gives us new life. See, the death on the cross made us right before God. That made us atoned for our sins. God sees us as he sees Jesus, right? Clean, washed clean. But the resurrection, that's what gives us hope. That's what gives us the power to overcome sin in our lives. That's what gives us the power to live freely, as Lucas was talking about, right? It's the power of the resurrection and the Holy Spirit living in our lives that we're able to overcome sin, flesh, and even death. It's the power of the resurrection that gives us hope and new life. And so the first thing was that he might know Christ, this intimate, personal knowing of Jesus. The second was that he might know the power of Christ's resurrection and the power that at work within him in his life. That same power that raised Christ from the dead lives in him, transforming him into new life. Okay, so the third thing is that he, is it says he wants to participate in his sufferings. Paul sought and desired to participate in the sufferings of Christ. I don't know. Seems a little crazy to me. But we've talked about this over the last couple times I've been here. I'm not going to go into it in all the detail I had before. But I'll just sum it up like this. The way to sanctification, the way of refining, often comes, or actually mostly comes, through suffering. God is at work in us in suffering. It's in the suffering that we're like Jesus. When we say, when Jesus prayed in the garden, "Not my will, but yours be done." It's a surrendering of ourself to the Lord and saying, "Jesus, I do not want to go through what I'm going through right now, but I'm going to trust you. Not my will, but yours be done. I'm going to be faithful to you through this. I'm going to turn to you. I'm going to cling to you in the midst of this because I know that you're at work even in the midst of this," right? And there's hope, and there's perseverance. Matthew Henry, again, points out that the apostle was as ambitious of being sanctified as he was of being justified. He was as desirous of knowing the power of Christ's death and resurrection, killing sin in him and raising him up to newness of life, as he was to receive the benefit of Christ's death and resurrection in justification. See, Paul sought Christ's work in him. He didn't just want to be saved for heaven. He wanted to be new. And you'll see this in the next one. He wanted to be transformed. Well, let's go ahead and go to the next one. The fourth one is that I might be conformed to the image of, he might be conformed to the image and likeness of Jesus Christ. That he might be conformed to the image and likeness of Jesus Christ. Intimacy. So Paul was seeking out, through suffering, through knowing Christ, to be transformed, to be conformed, to look like, act like, breathe like, smell like, love like Jesus. He wanted to be like Jesus so badly that he was willing to do anything, even suffer, so that he could be like Jesus. Everything else was lost. He just wanted to know Jesus and be like Jesus. That's it. That was his whole single-minded focus. If I can do this, it's going to be worth it. And it was worth it to him. He was willing to be shipwrecked, to be beaten, to be slandered, to be, you name it, cast out, go hungry, wander. He was willing to do it all because he knew it was worth it. Jesus was worth it to him. Intimacy between a husband and wife brings new life into the world. Right? So oftentimes, many times. Intimacy with Jesus brings new life into us. It's not that we have something we have to work hard for. It's not something that we have to strive for. We just have to be intimate and new life will be produced. To know him in this way. It's the natural result of knowing him. We simply draw close and new life happens. Paul talks about this as being conformed into the image and likeness of Jesus. John 15 talks about remaining in him. If we remain in him and he in us, then we will bear much fruit. It's a similar idea, a a different way of saying it. That's Jesus' way of saying it, right? If you remain in me and I remain in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do what? Nothing. Yeah. It's through remaining that new life is formed, that fruit is produced in our lives. And what does it look like to be conformed into the image of Christ? It is to bear much fruit. His fruit. Love. Joy. Peace. Peace. Oh man, don't we need more peace right now with everything that's going on in our world? And joy. Well, love too. I think we need a lot of all of these, really. Patience, kindness, self-control. These things we don't have to strive for. They happen when we abide. They happen when we know him and we seek and strive to know him more. When we have that intimacy with him, when we're spending time with him, when we're so single-minded on only knowing him that everything else is garbage, literally dung, that we don't want anything to do with that, we just want to know him more, new life happens. Fruit is produced in our life. We don't have to work at being patient when we're being intimate and remaining in him, because it just is, it happens. So how do we do this? What does it look like? How can we be conformed into the image of Jesus? Well, I don't have a whole lot of profound things to say other than just seek after him. The more you seek him, the more you will want to seek him, because he's good and he's worthy and he's worth it. The more that I seek him and the more I'm filled by him, the more that I'm hungry for him. It's a weird thing. I'll give you this analogy. Is when I gave up soda a few years ago, right? And it was a while ago now. It was when my wife was pregnant with our youngest, who's now 4. And at the time, it was really difficult, right? All I wanted was that soda, especially Coca-Cola. Oh, man. From a fountain. That was the best, or from a glass bottle. But I wanted that Coca-Cola so bad. But the longer that I was away from that garbage, the more that I sought what was good for me, the more I wanted what was good for me. And now when I go back and I try to dabble and try a little soda for my kids, I'm just like, oh, it's so gross, it's so sweet, so I can't even taste it anymore. I mean, it's just gross. But that wasn't the way it always was. I had to seek. I had to have a little bit of discipline and seek after the good and fill myself with the good so that I'd be hungry for more of the good. Another analogy is, you know, if our diet is always on McDonald's and Taco Bell and Wendy's, which it is oftentimes because we have young kids and they don't have as refined of a palate as myself. If we're always dining on this, then that's what we're going to be hungry for. But if we start to fill ourselves with good, healthy food that's actually good for us, right? And we eat this and we're filled by it, then we start to hunger for more of this. And we try to go back to McDonald's and we're like, oh, what was I doing? That is disgusting. Why would I ever put that in my body? Right? Because now we've been filled to the fullness with good things, and we now hunger for more good things. And it's the same with Christ. We fill ourselves with Christ. We seek after him. We read his word. We spend time with him in prayer. It's not complicated, but we actually have to do it, because then when we're filled with him and we've experienced him, we want nothing else but him. We want more of him. When we're filled with the world, we're left empty, and we're just like, ugh, I want more of something, and it seems like this is what I want. But then when we get filled with the Lord, he starts to fill us, and we're like, oh, no, actually, that what I had before, that isn't what I want. That was disgusting, and I actually want to throw it away, and I want more of the Lord. I want to follow after him more, and I want more of him. He's actually the only thing that I want. And so that's what I'm encouraging you today. And that's what Paul is saying. Single-mindedly, go after the Lord. Fill yourself with him, and you won't be disappointed. You won't be disappointed. Paul finishes here, and I'll wrap it up quick here, verses 12 through 14. And he says, just so that you guys know, not that I've already obtained all of this or have already arrived at the goal, but I press on to take hold of that which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself to have taken hold of it. But one thing I do is I'm forgetting what is behind and I'm straining toward what is ahead. I press on to the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. And I just want to finish with this. He doesn't say it's not attainable. He never says it's not attainable. I want to hear that because I've heard so many times so many Christians say, well, I can't be perfect, so I'm not even going to try. I'm not even going to go there, right? He doesn't say it's not attainable. He just says he hasn't made it yet. He hasn't obtained it yet, and he's striving with all of his might to obtain that, which Christ has called him to. There's a difference between something that's not obtained yet and something that's not attainable. So strive. Forget the difficulties. Forget the failures. Forget even your victories. Forget it all and press on towards knowing Christ more. When I was a runner in cross country, I didn't think about what I had already ran. I was thinking about one thing, the finish line, because I wanted to stop running. Right? I wanted to get there because I didn't want to run. I didn't think about the things that I maybe messed up on or the, you know, I've fallen down or even the good things where I passed other runners. I wasn't thinking about those things. I was thinking about one thing, the finish line. And so Christ is calling us, Paul is calling us to press on to knowing Christ more, to knowing the power of his resurrection in our lives to transform, to conform us more into the image of Christ. That is what Paul says is the most important, the only thing worth living for. Everything else is loss compared to knowing Christ Jesus, our Lord. Right? Amen. Can we say amen?
Amen?
So this week and on, strive. Continue on. I know that you're doing it, but this is just a spur you on. Keep going. Know Christ more. Know him. Know the power of the resurrection in us. We have the same spirit, the same power that raised Christ from the dead living in us to transform us. Know it. Participate in the sufferings of Christ. Know that it's a refining process of sanctifying us and making us more into the image of Christ so that we can be conformed into his image, in his likeness, so we can look like him, act like him, breathe like him, love like him, have joy like him, peace like him in the midst of any circumstance that the world has to offer. So, let's pray. Jesus, we thank you for your word. We thank you that you speak to us. We thank you for the ways that you love us and you call us to know you more. That is the ultimate gift, is to be able to know you, Lord. We might be filled with more of you. We might know your power to transform our lives. Lord, I pray for each one here, each one listening at home, that they would be encouraged, spurred on to chase after you, to count everything else as garbage, dung, worthless, throw it away, get rid of it, run away from it for the sake of knowing you. Let everything that might cause us to be double-minded, let it be thrown away, that we might be single-mindedly focused on knowing you and making you known. We love you, Jesus. We worship you because you are worthy and you're worth it. In Jesus' name, amen.
If you'll stand, please, for the final hymn, page 512, Jesus is all the world to me.
Yeah, may you go this week seeking to know him more, to be transformed and conformed into the image and likeness of Christ. Go in joy and in peace.